Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In our last lesson of the tafsir of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the seer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we looked at Surah Al-Abasa, which as we mentioned was a Meccan surah. So far we've not reached a Surah Al-Madaniyah, the Madani Surah, because the Madani Surah was after the Hijra of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So far we're looking at a Surah Al-Makkiyah. Today, insha'Allah ta'ala, we're going to be looking at the beginning of the Hijra of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, as we mentioned, the Hijra of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam itself was preceded by what? The Hijra of the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That every single one of the Sahaba, they left Mecca. The only people that remained in Mecca, mustad'afin. Those were too weak in prison and they were not allowed to leave Mecca. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr Asideeq radiallahu an, and Ali radiallahu an. These are the only people that remained in Mecca. And they wanted to leave because Abu Bakr Asideeq radiallahu an would go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yasta'dhinhu, asking for permission for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to go to where? To go to Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say to, Ya Abu Bakr, la ta'jal, la'allallah yaj'al laka sahiban. Abu Bakr, do not be hasty. Maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make for you a companion. Wa Abu Bakr radiallahu an kana yatma' an yakunahu. He used to wish and desire that that companion will be who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the mushrikeen of Quraysh, they're observing the situation that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has found helpers from other than them, Al-Ansar, that are ready to protect and fight for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They observe the fact that the Muslims had made hijrah to Medina and they established there a Dawla al-Islamiyah. So mushrikeen decided they have to do something about this. They have to put a stop to the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they decided to hold a conference. And any conference among the Quraysh which bore any importance will be held in Darul Nadwa. So Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he narrates what happened in this conference. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said the mushrikeen, when they saw the situation, they decided we have to hold a conference. And they invited all the ashraf of the Quraysh from the different tribes, all the nobles and aristocrats of the Quraysh to this conference. So Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said when they decided to hold this conference, they held it on a day yusamma yawm al-zahma, the day of congestion on the day of crowding. On that yawm al-zahma, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhum, I said, حتى اعترض لهم الشيطان في هيئة شيخ جليل. That even shaitan, to show how great that meeting was for them, he said, حتى اعترض Iblis. Not just any shaitan, shaitan himself, the Iblis. He attended that meeting and he came in the form of a sheikh, of an old man or a nobleman. Because a sheikh doesn't just mean one who possesses Islamic knowledge. There's a linguistic meaning, one old in age or one who is noble or high in status. So shaitan, he came in the form of an old man. Min ahli Najd, from the people of Najd. So when the Quraysh, they got to Darul Nadwa and they saw this old man, who they don't know from anywhere, standing by the door. They said, man is sheikh, who is the sheikh? The shaitan says, Shaykhun min al-Najd. I am a sheikh, a noble or old man from the people of Najd. Sami'tu, or Sami'a, he was talking a third party way form. So he has heard that which you gathered here for today. La'alla, or asa, la ya'dimukum ra'yan or nushan minhu. For the purpose that he is here, is that the sheikh is here, that maybe he may be able to assist you with some opinion and some advice. You don't want to miss out on his advice. You don't want to miss out on his opinion. So the Quraysh, they looked at this old man, they said, Ajal, okay, fadkhul, fadakhala ma'ahu. They said, enter, and the shaitan, Iblis, he entered with them. In this meeting, as we mentioned, all the ashraf, all the aristocrats and the noble of the Quraysh, they were there. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said each one represented their tribe. So they brought together all the tribes. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said, Min bani Abd al-Shams, from the tribe of Abd al-Shams, they had Utbah ibn Rabi'ah, they had Shaybah ibn Rabi'ah, and they had Abu Sufyan ibn Harb. These are the nobles of that particular tribe. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to select sent Utbah al-Rabi'a specifically for what? For la'na, for cursing and dua against them. And of course, we all know Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu is from Bani Abdul Shams. So from Bani Abdul Shams, they are these three. And from the other tribes, from Bani Nawfal ibn Abdul Manaf, they had Tu'ima ibn Adi, Jubair ibn Mut'im, Wal Harith ibn Amr ibn Nawfal. From Bani Abdul Dar ibn Qusay, they had another ibn al-Harith ibn Kalada. From Bani Asad ibn Abdul Uzza, they had Abu al-Bukhtari ibn Hisham, Zam'a ibn al-Aswad ibn al-Muttalib, wa Hakim ibn Hizam, who also later on became what? Became a Muslim. And from Bani Makhzum, one of the great times of Quraysh, they had Abu al-Hakam. Who's Abu al-Hakam? Abu Jahl. His name was really Abu Hakam, the father of knowledge and wisdom. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam nicknamed him Abu Jahl. They had Abu Hakam ibn Hisham. And for Bani Saham, they have Nubay ibn Munabbi' and his two sons Hajjaj. And from the tribe of Al-Jumah, they had Umayyah ibn Khalaf. And so on and so forth. So in this meeting, قَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ, they said one to the other, this affair of Muhammad has become too much. And the way they're going, and the authority they have, and the strength they have, they may one day revolt against us and actually meet us in battle and defeat us and take our affairs from our hand. And we're not going to leave Darun Nadwa hatta najtami' or najma ala ra'yin wahid. We're not going to leave here until we come to a consensus on what to do about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they gather together for Majlis al-Harb. It's like the equivalent of a security council or war council to deal with the issue of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they continue to debate and deliberate until one of them came out opinion. فَقَالَ أَحَدُهُمْ, one of them said, إِحْبِسُ, what you need to do with him, إِحْبِسُهُ بِالْحَدِيدِ, chain him up with chains. وَغْلِقُ عَلَيْهِ الْبَابِ, and lock him up completely in solitary confinement. ثُمَّ تَرَبَّسُ بِهِ, and just watch him. حَتَّى يُصِيبَهُ, until he's overcome by that which overcame those who came before him. زُهَيْر النَّابِغَ, these were some of the poets of the Arabs, that any poetry they made, if went against their custom, their culture, their beliefs, they used to lock them up in solitary confinement and watch them till they die. They say, watch him die a slow death. The Shaykh al-Najdi, the Shaykh from al-Najd, he said to them, he said, Wallahi, ma hadha lakum bi ra'i. He said, I swear to you by Allah, this is not a good opinion. Wallahi, la in habistumuhu kama taqulun, la yakhrujanna amruhu min wara'il bab. If you lock him up as you want to do, his affair or the news of being behind bar will come out from behind those doors. And his companions, who you've not locked up with him, they'll definitely come back to rescue him. And not only will they come back to rescue him, they'll revolt and fight against you. And trust me, they will defeat you. And they'll take the rules from you. You'll not be the rulers of Quraysh. He said, هَذَا لَيْسِ بِرَأْيِ, this is not a good opinion. He said, فَانْظُرُوا فِي غَيْرِهِ, think of something else. So they continue to deliberate. Because whatever they decide upon, it has to be a consensus. فَقَالَ قَائِلٌ مِّنْهُمْ, so one of them said, I've got an opinion. نُخْرِجُهُ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَظْهُرِنَا, we take him out from amongst us. فَنُفِيهِ مِنْ بِلَادِنَا, we expel him and deport him from our land. He said, after we've deported him and we've expelled him from our land, he said, فَوَاللَّهِ مَا نُبَالِ أَيْنَ ذَهَبَ وَلَا حَيْثُ وَقَعَ, after that we don't care where he goes, where he settles, we don't care at all. فَإِذَا غَابَ عَنَّا, once he's away from him, فَرَغْنَا, we're free from him. And after that, أَصْلَحْنَا أَمْرَنَا, we could rectify our affairs. وَأُلْفَتُنَا, and go back to that which we used to do before. Once he's away from us, the Shaykh al-Najdi said, لَا وَاللَّهِ, he said, by Allah, this is not a ra'i. He said, أَلَمْ تَرَوْ, why is this not a good opinion? He said, أَلَمْ تَرَوْ حُسْنَ حَدِيثِهِ, have you not seen how eloquent he is in his speech? Have you not seen حَلَاوَ مَنْتِقِهِ, have you not seen how sweet and how beautiful his logic and reasoning is? And have you not seen how he's able to conquer minds and hearts of men? Have you not seen this? He said, if you allow him to go anywhere else, he will go to one of the lands of the Arabs, and with this good speech, this way of conquering minds and hearts, they will follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it will not stop there. These same people that follow him will come back to you with them, and they will definitely defeat you. This is not a good opinion. So they continued. Until one of them, he said, that he's got an opinion. He said, Wallahi inna li fihi la ra'yan. I have an opinion. That none of you waqatum alayhi ba'd. That none of you have even mentioned yet. So they said, Wama huwa ya abal hakam. What is this opinion? Because they came to many conclusions, but no one came to this conclusion except for who? Abu Jahl. So they said to him, what is it, ya Abu al-Hakam? He said, Ara an na'khudha min kulli qabilatin. I see what we should do with him is from every single noble tribe. Take a man or young man of lineage and high position and status from every single tribe. And we give each and every single one of them safe asarin, a strong sword. And with this sword, they strike Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with it all at once and kill him. He said, after that now, tafarraqa, his blood will be divided amongst the what? The different tribes. He said, Abdul Manaf, which is the tribe of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, they could not fight all the tribes. They could only fight one or two tribes. But if they strike him all together, one blow, they can't fight all the tribes. He said, they will have no choice except after that, فَرَضُوا مِنَّا بِالْعَقْلِ. They have no choice but to be pleased with what? Diya, blood money. We just give them the blood money. He said, this is the opinion. فَقَالَ الشَّيْخَ النَّجْدِ. The Shaykh al-Najdi, he said, الْقَوْلْ مَا قَالَ هَذَا الرَّجُلِ. This is the right statement, what this man has said here. This is the proper thing to do. La ara ghayra. I don't see anything else but to assassinate Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they planned to assassinate the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jibreel alayhi salam, he revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam their plan. And he ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, La tabit. Hadhihi layla ala firashika allati kunta tabit alayhi. Do not sleep on your bed which you normally sleep in. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he called Ali radiallahu anhu. And he ordered Ali radiallahu anhu to sleep in his place and to cover himself with his blanket, al-hadrami, the hadrami green blanket of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Exactly the same blanket. Cover yourself with this. And he said to Ali radiallahu anhu, la yamassuka su, don't worry, nothing is going to happen to you. So the Quraysh, when it reached Atman min al-layl. Atman min al-layl means the darkest part of the night. And why did they go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the darkest time of the night? Why? After Isha. Well, after Isha. Because to show their level of surveillance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they knew the full program of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like we said, Abu Lahab, his wife, used to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam everywhere, even till night time. So they knew that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, during the night, what does he normally do? Ya ayyuhal muzammil qum al-layla illa qalila. He'll stand up for qiyam. And in those days, the bathrooms were not in the house. He has to get up, go outside, make wudu, and come back. So they went there late at night, at the time of qiyam, waiting for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. At this point, being confident or overconfident that their plan was going to be successful and they're going to succeed in what they were going to do, Abu Jahl and those with him went to the door. And Abu Jahl, he gave a speech at the door. Abu Jahl, he said, وَهُوَ عَلَى بَابِهِ. Upon the door of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he turned to the people and said, إِنَّ مُحَمَّدًا يَزْعُمُ. You see this Muhammad we're about to kill? يَزْعُمُ. He claims that أَنَّكُمْ إِن تَبَعْتُمُوهُ عَلَى أَمْرِهِ كُنْتُمْ مُلُوكُ الْعَرَبِ وَالْعَجَمِ. He claims that if you follow him, later on you're going to become the kings and the leaders of the Arabs and the non-Arabs. ثُمَّ إِذَا بُعِثْتُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَوْتِكُمْ فَجُعِلَتْ لَكُمْ جِنَانَ كَجِنَانِ الْأُرْدُ. And he also claims, after you become the kings and then you die and then you're raised up again, you're going to have gardens and paradise like the gardens of Jordan. This is the claim of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then went on to say, وَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا. And if you do not do it, Muhammad claims he's going to slaughter you. This is the person who gathered his daughter to slaughter now. And then after he slaughters you, جُعِلَتْ لَكُمْ نَار. Fire will be made for you that you're going to be burnt in. So he was mocking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. At this point, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kharaja min baytihi. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came out of his house. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took dust in his hand. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while coming out of his house, he said, Na'am, yes, ana aqulu thalika. Yes, I say this. وَأَنْتَ أَحَدُهُمْ And you're one of them that's going to burn in the hellfire. At that point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it took away their what? Their sight. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took away their sight. They couldn't see anything. They could not see nothing at all. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited the ayah from Surah Yasin. Yasin والقرآن الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم. Yasin, I swear by the Quran al-Hakim, innaka lamin al-mursaleen. Verily you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, min al-mursaleen. You're from the messengers, ala siratin mustaqim, upon the straight path. Until the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reached the saying of Allah azza wa jal, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ سَدًّا وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ سَدًّا فَأَغْشَيْنَاهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ That we've made a barrier in front of them, a barrier behind them. فَأَغْشَيْنَاهُمْ We've covered them completely. فَهُمْ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ They could not see. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the dust in his hand, he sprinkled it on each and every single one of them. He put it on their heads. Each and every single one. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam escaped from amongst them. Didn't see anything. So while this was happening, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam finished reading these ayat and he passed by them, فَأَتَاهُمْ آتٍ مِمَّنْ لَمْ يَكُمْ مَعَهُمْ Somebody came that was not with them. And he saw them outside the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, مَاذَ تَنْتَظِرُونَ هَا هُنَا He asked, what are you not waiting for here? They said, مُحَمَّدًا قَالَ They said, waiting for Muhammad. Say, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala humiliate you. He said, قَدْ وَاللَّهِ خَرَجَ عَلَيْكُمْ مُحَمَّدْ ثُمَّ مَا تَرَكَ مِنْكُمْ رَجُلًا إِلَّا وَقَدْ وَضَعَ عَلَى رَأْسِهِ تُرَابًا He said, Muhammad has left. And he did not just only leave. He did not leave except he left a dust on each and every single one of his head. At that moment, in their suspicion, each one of them, they touched their head. And what did they find on their head? They found the dust. But they still did not believe it. So what did they do? They looked into the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they were confident. He's still sleeping on his bed. But it was Ali radiallahu anhu that was sleeping. And they found the exact covering of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam upon Ali. So they looked in. And they said, you know what? He's not left there. So they waited. Wallahi, inna hadha la Muhammad na'iman. They said, wallahi, this Muhammad is sleeping. Alayhi bardu. Upon him is his covering. Not only is he sleeping, that's his specific covering. So they stayed like that, hatta asbahu, until morning. At the morning time, Ali radiallahu anhu, he came out. He woke up. And at that moment, they said to each other, Wallahi laqad sadaqana ladhi hadathana. The one who told us this, Wallahi, was truthful in the first place. But what we have to ask ourselves is, the ward or the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was not something difficult for them to enter and enter upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and just kill him while he's sleeping. And they killed Ali radiallahu anhu. So why did they not do this? Why didn't they just go in while he's asleep and kill him? And it's a question when it comes to this qissa, this incident, I've always asked myself, they just enter and kill him, full stop. And they killed Ali radiallahu anhu, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was confident, la yamassuka as-su, nothing bad will happen to you. Why didn't they just go in? Some of the mufassirin, they say, while they were attempting, the initial plan was to go in and kill the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam while he was asleep. So he said, فَصَاحَتْ إِمْرَأَةٌ مِنَ الدَّارِ They heard from the house a woman screaming or making noise. From inside the house. فَقَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ إِنَّهَا لَصُبَّ فِي الْعَرَبِ أَنْ يَتَحَدَّثْ أَنَّا تَصَوَّرْنَا الْحَيْطَانِ عَلَى بَنَاتِ الْعَمِّ They said it would be a disgrace. Subhanallah. Look at the Arabs of those days. And a shame for the Arabs to hear that we climbed over the wall and we entered upon our cousin, our female cousins. It's a shame. It would be a shame for them to hear that we've broken the sitr, the covering, and the veil of a woman. And they were mushrikeen. Because they don't know what state that woman's in. And these were mushrikeen. We could not go in there. And it would be said about us, you know, they went in while this woman was maybe in an indecent state. So that's what kept them there. When they heard a woman is in the house, they didn't go in. So they stayed outside, hatta asbahu, and they found Ali radiallahu anhu. Of course, when they caught Ali radiallahu anhu, they beat him severely, they took him to the Kaaba and tied him to the Kaaba and asked him, i'tarif, where is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Fama qala kalima. He didn't say a single thing. Now, from morning to later on, where did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam go? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to the one who he said to him, la'allallahu yaj'al laka sahiban. Maybe Allah will make a companion for you. Abu Bakr Asideeq, who was truly hoping it would be him. But to show the sincerity of the hope and the desire of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu that will make hijrah with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had already prepared. And this shows sincerity, that when you're really serious about something, you prepare for it. And that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is about the munafiqeen. We did not go out in jihad. لو أرادوا الخروج لا عدوا له عدة. If they really wanted to go for jihad, what would they have done? They would have prepared for it. If a person really, 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 really wants to do something, he prepares for it. If you do not want to do it, you're not going to prepare for it. I know some people, every year, they buy the ihram. They've not saved enough money, but they buy the ihram. They buy everything they need for hajj, and by the grace of Allah Azza wa Jal, you'd find they go for hajj or umrah. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he wasn't sure it would be him or not, but he was already prepared. Abu Bakr, from when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, he bought 2 riding animals specifically for that purpose, and he kept them in his house, feeding them, hoping that day will come that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, "Anta sahibi, you're my partner on the hijrah." So he was prepared, fully prepared, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha radiallahu anha, when he reached the house of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Aisha said radiallahu anha, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he never ever 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 came to our house except ahadu tarafay al-nahar, except one of the 2 times during the day, either in the morning or reaching the evening. That's the time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will come there. And the mushrikeen, they know the program of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But she said on this particular day, atana rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi sa'atin la yati fiha. He came on this particular day at a time he never comes. Subhanallah, to show the takhteet, the planning of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because if he went at the normal times, they know the normal time he goes there. Secondly, she said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came at the time the sun was at its peak, almost near Dhuhr. And why would the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam choose this time? Because everybody in their house, it's too hot. Nobody was outside, because you would have thought it would have gone under the cover of dark. But when the sun, and it's fully bright, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went to the house, Abu Bakr. قالت فلما رآه أبو بكر قال ما جاء رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم هذه الساعة إلا لأمر حدث. When Abu Bakr saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was shocked. He said nothing could have brought him at this time except something has happened. So Abu Bakr al-Siddiq تأخر له. He delayed in getting up from his bed to go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فجلس رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. She said he went to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and the Prophet and nobody was Abu Bakr al-Siddiq illa ana wa ukhti Asma bint Abu Bakr, except for me and my sister Asma bint Abu Bakr. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to Abu Bakr, to show the level of secrecy and care and security, he said to Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, akhrij man indak. Tell everybody to leave the room. Whoever is here, tell them to leave. And how old is Aisha radiallahu anha? How old is she at this time? Because she married the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when she was what? 6. And the marriage is consummated at 9. So imagine how young she was then. He said, akhrij kullu man indak. Tell everybody to leave the room. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that, ya Rasulullah, innahuma ibnatay. These are my 2 daughters. Then the Prophet ﷺ looked around even further. He said, "Wa man dhak?" Who are those people over there? He said, "That's my mother and my father." Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after trusting them, he began to speak. He said to Abu Bakr radiallahu an, "Inna Allah qad adhina li fil khuruj wal hijra." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the permission to leave in hijra. قالت فقال أبو بكر. At this point, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he asked in excitement, الصحبة الصحبة, am I going to be your companion? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الصحبة, you're going to be my companion. Aisha radiallahu anhu, she said, فوالله, I swear by Allah عز وجل, ما شعرت قط قبل ذلك اليوم أن أحدا يبكي من الفرح. I never could able to conceive or imagine before that day that anybody will cry out of happiness, hatta yabki Abu Bakr yawma idhin, until Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he cried out of happiness on that day. She never witnessed that before, that somebody could cry out of happiness. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he began to cry out of happiness. And then he said, ya Nabi Allah, O Messenger of Allah, inna hatain rahilatan qad kuntu a'dadtuhuma lihada. He said, you see these 2 riding animals? I prepared them for this day. He was ready. And not only did he prepare them for this day, he had already hired a guide, Abdullah Ibn Uraiqit. Abdullah Ibn Uraiqit was the best guide in the Arabian Peninsula. He knew all the rules and he was a mushrik. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had an animal, he had the guide, and he gave the two riding animals to him. He said, meet us at the appointed place and time after 3 days. And he trusted him, a mushrik, he gave it to him. Then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, to show the level of secrecy, even the way he left his house, he didn't leave from the front of the house. He left from where? The back of the house. And nobody knew that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was leaving except for those who had to know. Abu Bakr, of course, Ali radiallahu anhu. And why did Ali have to know? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had wadi'a. He had things which was placed with him as trust from even the mushrikeen. That he left with Ali, this belongs to this person, that belongs to this person. He didn't want to leave and say, you know what, I'm going for hijrah. Everyone's, you know, what they entrusted me with, their property, you know, ma'as salama. No, he left Ali radiallahu anhu in charge of giving back the people's amana. So Ali had to know. And of course, Abdullah ibn Abi Bakr. Abdullah, the son of Abu Bakr. And also the Mawla, the slave of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Amir ibn Fuhayra. And we know why they have to know later on. So they left the house Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and they entered to Ghar al-Thawr. Where's Ghar al-Thawr? Because all the journey they took was what? Southwards. Where Medina is what? North. To deceive them. So they went to Ghar al-Thawr. Upon reaching Ghar al-Thawr, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he refused for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to enter the Ghar. Because they reached there at night. He refused for the Prophet ﷺ to enter فَدَخَلَ Abu Bakr until he entered. And he was searching for any possibility of a sab' of scorpion on hay or hayya afwan or snake to protect the Prophet ﷺ. And he took off his cloth and he cut it into pieces and blocked every single hole he can in that ghar al-thawr. So no snake, no scorpion could attack the Prophet ﷺ. After he was assured that this place is safe, the Prophet ﷺ entered and the Prophet ﷺ, he slept and he put his head on the lap of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he noticed in Ghar al-Thawr that there was two holes that was not covered. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he put his foot there to cover it. When he put his foot there to cover it, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was bitten by a scorpion. And he was extremely painful. He held it in and it was painful. But he held it in, but the pain was too much. But he didn't want to wake up the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did not scream, nor did he move, until his eyes swelled with tears, and the teardrop started to drop on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet said, what is wrong with you? He said, ludiqtu, I've been bitten by a scorpion. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, bismillah, he touched him in dua, and he was healed, ka'annahu lam yakun, as though it did not happen at all. Subhanallah, look at the sacrifice of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. His wealth, even his own family, his slave, for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they stayed in this ghar, and the reason Abdullah ibn Abu Bakr had to be from the people that knew was what? He was ordered by Abu Bakr before he left the house. Every day, the daytime, just hang around and linger and hear the news of what the Quraysh are discussing. And from that which they're discussing, Abu Jahl went to the Kaaba. He said, anyone that finds Muhammad mi'ata ibil, it's like a million riyal, I'll give them 100 camels. That's the ransom. So the bounty hunters were all looking for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he will stay in Mecca during the day, and in the evening he will bring to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam what they were discussing. And the other person was who? Ibn Fuhayra, Amir ibn Fuhayra. What would he do? He will graze the cattle of Abu Bakr and the Quraysh during the daytime, and then after Abdullah has left, he will follow him to give milk and meat to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Abdullah, when he leaves in the evening, who follows him? Amir ibn Fuhayra. Why does he follow him? To wipe out his footmarks. With the what? With the animals. So he'll go after him. So he was wiping out the footmarks. And of course, Asma bint Abu Bakr, who used to bring food to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To the point the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam named or nicknamed her that nitaqain, the one who has two belts. Because she have one belt for food for herself and one belt food for Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So they stayed like this in this cave for 3 nights. Now during one of those nights, the mushrikeen actually even found the place. They found the place, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, they could hear the voice of the mushrikeen min kharij al-ghar. In fact, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu through the holes of the cave, he could see their what? Their foot. And he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, لو نظر أحدهم إلى موضع قدمي ليرانا. If one of them just looks down, he's going to see us. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, O Abu Bakr, ما ظنك بإثنين الله ثالثهما. What do you think of two people that Allah is the third of them? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the ayah when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Abu Bakr, لا تحزن إن الله معنا. It was said Abu Bakr was fearful. But fearful for what? For himself? No. Fearful for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because some of the munafiqeen wa ahlu bid'ah min al-shi'a, they said Abu Bakr was scared. If he was scared, he would not have left with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the first place. If he was scared, he would not have prepared for that day. But rather, he was fearing for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah ta'ala did not say in the ayah that he said to him, لا تخاف. But rather, he said what? لا تحزن. Do not be sad. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was not scared. So they stayed in this cave for 3 nights, waiting for who to come to them? Abdullah ibn Ruqayqah to come to them with the riding animals, their guide. So while they're in this place for 3 days, the mushrikeen, they were still looking for who? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The only people they could go to was who? Ali. They gave up on him, tortured him, left him. Another one they could go to was who? The household of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So Abu Jahl, he went to the household of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And when he go to the house of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he said to her, Ya bint Abu Bakr, daughter Abu Bakr, call Asma. And she said about Abu Jahl, that this Abu Jahl was a person fahishan khabithan. So she said, Ya bint Abu Bakr, where is your father? She said, La adri wallahi, I don't know where they are wallah. He said, where is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He asked for, he said, I don't know. Where's your father? She said, I don't know. Farafa'a Abu Jahl yadahu. He raised his hand and he slapped her so hard on her cheek, her earring fell off her ear. No, she said, Taraha, the earring flew off her ears. And she still didn't give up. She never revealed the secret of where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. After 3 nights had passed, their guide, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he took the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam out of this cave. But subhanAllah, when you look at usul al-idara, the fundamentals and principle, whether it's project management, whether it's administration, you find all of this in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whether it's about planning, whether it's about strategy, whether it's about delegating. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this was a mushrik. He didn't say, you know what, let me look for a Muslim brother who's better. No, this is his job. There was nobody better at that than him. Of course, if there's a Muslim who could do the job, wallahi nufaddilu Muslim. Even if we do it 75% as him, but there was nobody like him. It's a mushrik. But you know what? That's the right person for the job. Because somebody's a sheikh, is knowledgeable, is pious, he may not be the right person for that particular job. But this was the right person for a job. But if there's a Muslim, it should be the one that should appoint. And that's why today's khutbah where I prayed, it was talking about Ali radiallahu anhu and the sacrifice of Ali radiallahu anhu. To the point that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one day said to the Sahaba during Fathul Khaybar, he said, Ghadan, or tomorrow in the morning, لَأُعْتِيَنَّ رَايَ. Tomorrow I'm going to give this flag. لِرَجُلٍ يُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَيُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. I'm going to give this flag to a man that loves Allah and His Messenger. And Allah and His Messenger they love. And everyone of the Sahaba wishing it was them. And would the Prophet give it to? Ali radiallahu anhu. And he said to him in the morning, go and call Ali. But Ali had an injury or dust in his eye. He could not hardly see. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he blew in his eyes and his eyes became okay. And he said, go to the Yahud. When you descend, the first thing you do, call them to La ilaha illallah. The point of the matter he was trying to make here is the Khatib was saying it's obligatory for us to give da'wah to the Muslims and the non-Muslims, especially those who are under us from those who work with us. And he said, these non-Muslims that are working with us or for us, al-asr al-man'a, the asr of it is not even permissible to have a non-Muslim maid, servant, driver in your house, and you could bring a Muslim. Because some people say they're more sincere, there's no Jumu'ah, no prayer, they more. Forget all of that. It is better to employ a Muslim. Get that in your head. If it's equally or even lesser, not as good, but not to the point he doesn't know what he's doing, he said you should not be bringing these people to work in your house or in your land. They'll take over from you. He said, especially in the household of some of the locals, he was saying that he's a Qatari himself. He said, look, I have uncles, we have cousins. He said, especially in the time when women are so complacent, that the one that's really raising the child is the what? The maid. He said, I heard this statement for so many of my nephews and nieces, that when something happens, there's no subhanallah, ya Allah. They say, jeez. Jeez, meaning Jesus Christ. So al-asl, it should be a Muslim. Anyway, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he delegated for this person, Abu Bakr radiallahu anh, to lead him. Now, after these 3 days, and he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he led them out of the cave. He headed, we said Medina is what? North, but he headed south. And he took a path, almost going towards the Red Sea, that nobody ever takes. Then he began the journey, what? Northwards. Now on this journey, there's a couple of incidents that happened, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, before reaching Medina, we'll speak about, but subhanAllah. When they left at night, they walked the whole night until morning, and then continued to walk until the afternoon. Imagine walking all of that time, and continuing, and continuing, and continuing, on the animal, and then walking until they rested. And after that, they reached a place called the Khaymah, the tent of Ma'bad. We'll look at this incident, inshallah ta'ala, next week. This will take us a couple of weeks, even before they get to Medina, because of loads of incidences that happened before that. But before going to the Medina, we're going to go back to Ayat al-Makiyah, and we'll conclude with those, inshallah. Any questions, inshallah? Now.